Aloha and welcome to ThinkTech, where we're raising public awareness about technology, energy, globalism, and diversification. As part of the ThinkTech series, today's show is Global Connections, and I'm your host, Carlos Juarez. I'm really delighted to welcome today a guest that's joining us here in the Pioneer Plaza at the core of downtown Honolulu. I'm joined today by Pierre Asselin. He's a historian at Hawaii Pacific University and has just recently published a very exciting pathbreaking book that we're going to talk all about, Hanoi's Road to the Vietnam War, 1954 to 1965. But first, let me just welcome you, Pierre, and thank you for joining us here in this opportunity to learn more about your work and this book and really the contribution it makes to our understanding of the Vietnam War. Before we jump into it, I just want to remind our listeners that we are broadcasting live on the internet at 2 o'clock and at 4 o'clock each weekday. All of our shows are streamed on ustream.tv and spreaker.com. And if you want live access to those live streams, you can also go to thinktechhawaii.com, and you can get links there. It's also saved as a podcast that you can pull up later and find on YouTube. If you'd like to join us here in the downtown gallery at any time for any of our shows, just write to j@thinktechhawaii.com. So basically, I want to turn to Pierre and just excited to learn about this recent book you've published, and perhaps to help let our listeners know a little bit about yourself. Tell us, you're a historian, a diplomatic historian, but give us some of your own background. Now, you've been here in Hawaii some time.
Sure. Well, thanks for having me, Carlos. Yeah. This is a real treat to be here and talk about the book, among other things. I'm not, because I'm working on Vietnam, people often assume that I'm French. I'm actually French-Canadian. Uh-huh. I'm from Quebec City in Canada. I grew up in a very, very homogeneous neighborhood. We were all white, French-speaking, Catholic. I had no exposure to Asia whatsoever. I kind of discovered Asia, bad as this sounds, through watching Rambo movies.
Oh gosh! Conquest in Vietnam.
Essentially, what happened is that I was during my last year of high school. I show up for history class one day, and I'm we're asked to basically consider writing a paper on a topic having to do with violence in the Western world. Mm-hmm. So I went to the teacher after class and I said, I watched this movie last night about this guy Rambo fighting the Chinese, and I'd like to work on that war. And he said, well, actually, Pierre, because I think that was the Vietnam War. Again, being from Quebec, yeah. Chinese, Vietnamese, bad as this sounds, I couldn't tell the difference. And so I started working on the Vietnam War at that point, mm-hmm. very, very crude understanding of it. Yeah. Shortly afterwards, I go to college, Platoon comes out, I eventually take a class from a professor who's Vietnamese, and mm-hmm. from that moment on, I realized I like history, and specifically, mm-hmm. I like the history of the Vietnam War. And at first it was the American experience in Vietnam, mm-hmm. and now it's really kind of the Vietnamese communist experience, mm-hmm. during that same conflict.
Oh, excellent. And so, as you reminded us, I mean, you grew up in Canada. Your studies for undergraduate were done in Toronto, I recall?
Yeah. So I went to school. Yeah. I was supposed to go to school in Quebec City because
that was home.
Yeah, that was home, exactly. Yeah. And then the summer before I was to enter university, I went to work in Toronto to basically perfect my English. Mm-hmm. Quebec, again, parts of Canada are bilingual, Quebec is not. Yeah. So I spent the summer in Toronto, and while I was there, it crossed my mind to perhaps try and go to school in Toronto. So I went to a place called Glendon College, part of York University in mm-hmm. Toronto, got my BA from there, and that's where I met the Vietnamese professor I mentioned earlier, and then went and pursued a master's degree at the University of Toronto before coming to Hawaii to study for my PhD at the University of Hawaii, mm-hmm. because they had a very good, and still do, a Vietnamese language program, mm-hmm. and Vietnamese studies program.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And as a window to Asia here in Hawaii, you were able to come and be more immersed. In many ways, you've got Asia right here in our backyard.
Exactly,
But you had, I love the story of how, often the puzzles of how did you find yourself, it's watching Rambo and showing up to a high school, oh my gosh, I have to write a paper, and one thing, and here we are, you're fast fast forward some years, and now you've become a very important scholar of the Vietnam War and different aspects. And let me first just mention that your earlier book that you published some years ago, when did this earlier one come out?
This was in 2002.
2002, about 10 years ago, a decade ago. This is a book called A Bitter Peace, Washington, Hanoi, and the Making of the Paris Agreement. It's also been published in Vietnamese, which is valuable because it allows your insights, your research to be shared with the Vietnamese community. And maybe give us a quick snapshot. This early work, which came out of obviously your previous research, looked more at the negotiations over the ending of the war, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So tell us briefly, what was this covering?
This is essentially my PhD dissertation, mm-hmm. that would eventually be turned into a book. And I was planning initially on working on the American bombing campaigns that ended the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. And so when I left to do research at the National Archives, by complete accident, I came across a collection of documents having to do with the secret negotiations to end the war.
These archives were in the U.S.?
This was actually in the U.S. This was at College Park. Those were the Nixon archives, which because of Watergate, were still in the custody of the National Archives and Records Administration in Maryland. So the materials hadn't been transferred to the Nixon Library just yet because of Watergate.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I'm going through materials, and I came across this collection of documents about the Paris peace talks. Mm-hmm. And so I decided to start working on that. So initially I collected materials to relate the American experience in those talks. Mm-hmm. And then I went to Vietnam, and to my surprise, was able to find a lot of Vietnamese materials on the Vietnamese communist experience in those same talks. And so the dissertation and hence the book became about the Washington Hanoi secret negotiations to end the war.
Because again, many of us who may just have a more superficial knowledge of the war, we know, of course, the war ensues for a long time, became a very powerful, episode in our history. But the process that brought it to an end, indeed, was an ongoing one, but also one that was tightly controlled and at the time kept very under wraps, very secretive to negotiate that settlement. And I'm curious if you might relate. I mean, the title itself, A Bitter Peace, so it ends the war, but it was a very contentious, difficult.
One of the things that I learned through my research is just how difficult it can be to end a war. Mm-hmm. We look at current conflicts in Iraq, Afghanistan, and we think, okay, this is expensive. It should be ended at mm-hmm. once. We've been having these debates for quite some time. But the thing is, if you're a decision maker, there's a lot more at stake here. Mm-hmm. So and sure enough, for Nixon, for instance, ending the war was one thing, but preserving American credibility mm-hmm. vis-a-vis the rest of the world, vis-a-vis his own people, mm-hmm. vis-a-vis the Chinese, the Soviets, those things were very, very important. Yeah. And the book shows the kind of the challenges that both sides faced mm-hmm. as they sought to end the war. Ultimately, they do reach an agreement, but it's essentially an agreement that was far from perfect, mm-hmm. and that I claim in the book essentially satisfied no one. Mm-hmm. So it was a necessary peace, but it was also a bitter peace. And the bitterness was such that when it came time to implement the agreement, none of the parties were seriously really committed to it, and hence it collapsed
at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that, and there we see the dramatic ending and
the
very tumultuous time, and of course for the U.S. something we've had to wrestle with for quite some time and an impact on our own, popular culture, media, everything. Now, fast forward now, and here you've now got a decade later after that study, you found yourself carrying on a pretty long and extensive process to bring you to this new book of yours, Hanoi's Road. And this, rather than the tail end, kind of looks at the early other side of the story, because of course you have a good understanding of how difficult it was at the end. Give us a quick story. And again, for Americans, often we have a sense of, well, the war must have started when we showed up, and obviously it went on for about a decade, but no, the war has deeper roots and goes back quite a bit.
Exactly, and this is, the main argument that I make in this book is basically that the Vietnam War began before the United States committed its own forces. Mm-hmm. So the U.S. commits troops to, Lyndon Johnson mm-hmm. commits U.S. troops to South Vietnam in the spring of 65. In the book, I make the claim that big war in Vietnam mass combat operations had actually begun in late 64. Mm-hmm. And in this sense, the Americanization of the war was essentially a reaction to a war that was already in progress in Vietnam. Yeah. So there's been a tendency in this country to almost invariably place the United States in the middle of any situation. The U.S. is always the one actor controlling events.
Like World War I doesn't start until we show up to end it.
Exactly.
World War II, well, 41, you know, they invade us, then we get in.
So, you know, I mean, we've had books written entitled, you know, Lyndon Johnson's War or Nixon's War and so on and so forth. And that's the thing. In this particular case, this was a tragic conflict. And there's no question that the United States helped create the circumstances that led to that tragic conflict. But, and this is what the book intends to do or seeks to do, we need to understand that on the other side, there were also individuals, parties, decisions that created circumstances which I claim in the book were even more significant in precipitating the Vietnam War.
So I'm fascinated because obviously what your book as a path-breaking study does is it's able to unravel a lot of archives and materials that really had only recently been made available. And talk a little bit about that process, because you obviously were able to, and or maybe even before you get to that, I mean, you made yourself out to the University of Hawaii to pursue the PhD studies, but also language learning to be able to then not only read, you know, the American and even French, but having access to the Vietnamese. I mean, how was that itself as an educational part? Because you have a working knowledge now Vietnamese that allows you to see their materials. And this is rather unique and important for us. And as somebody doing history, being able to read those documents, the original work.
It's invaluable. I mean, it's you know, a lot of people, as you know, I've looked at the Vietnam War, have studied the Vietnam War, but very few people have actually tried to understand the other side on its own terms, or even America's allies, the South Vietnamese, on their own terms. Mm-hmm. And so my Vietnamese is not good, but it's decent enough to allow me to read archival materials and hence to access those materials. The thing is this, I mean, so the first book was about basically two sides. This book focuses exclusively on the communist side and specifically the communist decision-making side. Mm-hmm. And there's two things here. There's the need to know Vietnamese, which I was okay with, but then there's the ability to access archival materials. As you know, and I'm sure as your viewers know, Vietnam remains a communist country.
So that access is still
and
a challenge.
It very closely guards its archives.
Sure.
The Chinese have been much more forthcoming in terms of releasing materials, although that's beginning to change. But the Vietnamese have always been very, very conservative in their approach to the release of archival materials. And so, and that's been a really big challenge.
Yeah. Yeah.
And one of the reasons it took so long to put this together is I really wanted to use as much as possible Vietnamese sources from Vietnam, official documentation and official histories. Mm-hmm. The problem is there's no law or set of rules governing the release of classified materials in Vietnam. So that's a big challenge. The U.S. has, 25-30-year rule. Now it's technically 10 years, although it usually takes longer than that. But there's no such rule in Vietnam. And so essentially what needs to happen is one has to go to the archives, work, be patient, develop relationships with archivists. And over time, I was able to see more and more materials. Mm-hmm. I never bribed anyone, and I would never do that. But I basically had to establish myself as a legitimate Vietnam scholar in the eyes of these guys.
And building those relationships. And this is so critical, especially for doing history, understanding both the patience needed. And I want to continue this conversation in just a moment. We're going to need to take just a short break. We'll be back in just a moment. I'm Carlos Juarez, and this is Global Connections in the ThinkTech series. We're joined today by Pierre Asselin, and having a great conversation to learn about all of what goes into producing a book of this type, a history that really brings us new materials, new perspectives from the perspective of Hanoi. We'll come back right after a short break, so stay tuned.
Hi, how are you? Are you feeling good? Are you feeling lucky? ThinkTech Hawaii, it puts a bubble in my blender. If you don't feel good, that's your fault. Now that's live TV, folks.
Welcome, and we're back, we're live, and we're ThinkTech. This is Global Connections. I'm your host, Carlos Juarez, and we've been joined today by Pierre Asselin. He's got a new book just recently published by the University of California Press, Hanoi's Road to the Vietnam War, 1954 to 1965. And Pierre, you're getting a chance to tell us a little bit how this history is made, because, I mean, of course, you're looking at documents, original documents in Vietnam itself, and the challenge of, you know, what it takes to get access to that, a country that, of course, is guarding its state, you know, records very carefully, obviously is concerned about how the story might be told. But nevertheless, you persist, and over many years of carrying out research, and as we'll see, research in other places too. But maybe tell us a little bit more about the challenges in Vietnam of trying to gather information like this. This is pretty sensitive information.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of time spent waiting around to get permission to access archives and so on and so forth. But essentially, you know, Vietnam is a one-party state. The juiciest archives are those of the Vietnamese Communist Party. Mm-hmm. Those are closed to not just foreign, but even Vietnamese scholars.
So these would have been records of meetings, and somebody took notes and kept them.
That's what we like to think, assuming they were taking notes. But this would be like, you know, the core decision makers getting together, minutes of meetings. We have these kinds of things from the American side during that same time period. Mm-hmm. We don't have it on the Vietnamese side. Yeah. We're pretty sure they exist, but we don't even know that because, again, those archives are completely sealed. Mm-hmm. So then there's the government archive. So you know, we have the party, which is basically the decision-making body in Vietnam, and then there's the government, which typically is tasked with implementing party policies. And I've been working in those archives. The thing is that every once in a while, as you dig through these government archives, you come across party documents.
That kind of slipped in.
Exactly, that's exactly it, that you ask for materials, and again, essentially, when you look at the indexes, you can ask for anything you want, but then what happens is then they'll pull the documents off the shelves, and then there'll be kind of a vetting process.
Yeah, right?
They'll
then see, make sure they know what you're getting
to
look at.
To see how sensitive the information is. And usually the juiciest files, the most promising files are denied. But every once in a while in those other files, you might come across a document that probably you shouldn't have seen, but was in there. And this happened, again, over a 10-year period on several occasions. One document in particular was so good, was so rich in terms of information that I decided not to use it. Because
a little too sensitive or it could.
I thought it might get the people at the archives in trouble, basically. It talked about an issue we know very little about, essentially dissidents in northern Vietnam. During the early 1960s, just as there would be opposition to Johnson, Nixon administration in this country, there was a opposition to the leadership in Hanoi, mm-hmm. even before mm-hmm. the war began.
Yeah.
But of course, these are not the kinds of things that are publicized mm-hmm. In Vietnam, and which we don't really even talk about in the West. And I had found this 50-page document.
Mm.
I'd spent 5 days writing the whole thing verbatim, but ultimately, I'm basically still sitting on it,
yeah.
but I haven't used it, just because, again, I mean, it's. I just don't want to compromise my relationship with the people at the archives, who've been very, very good to me, mm-hmm. and basically allowed me to put this book together.
And from the vantage point of them, I mean, you're a foreign scholar coming there. I don't know, but does it help that you've got your Canadian credentials? Is that anything that they're aware of?
Not
really. They just know you're a foreign scholar. You're you know what, sort of Westerner coming there.
What helps is, as I was suggesting earlier, is basically kind of ultimately being able to prove that you're a serious academic.
Yeah, yeah.
When I first went to Vietnam and worked in the archives, I was still a grad student. And it was challenging. And I remember at the time there were established professors there. Mm-hmm. And I was so envious of the way those guys were treated mm-hmm. relative to how I was treated.
Yeah.
You know? And it's so funny because I was at the archives in Hanoi this past summer, and this grad student from Berkeley comes to me at one point and says, you're so lucky. Like, I look at the way they treat you, they're so nice to you, and they're so rude to me. And it kind of made me laugh because I thought, you know what, about 14 years ago, I was exactly in the position you're in right now, feeling the way you do right now.
Yeah,
and so it's not that I'm Canadian, it's just, it's just building relationships, mm-hmm. building trust, and ultimately demonstrating to the archivists in Vietnam who are very competent people that you are a serious academic, and that you, it seems that they think that you do serious work.
Yeah. No, fascinating. Now, you, of course, have turned to a lot of the materials, especially to understand Hanoi's perspective in Vietnam, but, of course, there's a wealth of information in other sites. And so tell us a little bit about that. Of course, from the U.S. Archives, we've got a large, wealth of information, and yet, depending on where you're looking, it's going to be different pieces. But outside of the U.S., outside of Vietnam, other places where you've had to gather information about this?
Essentially, what I wanted to do was to relate the story of the communist role to the Vietnam War on the basis of their own materials. Now, for reasons I've just explained, I wasn't able to find enough materials to tell the story strictly on the basis of Vietnamese documentation. So I started looking at American documents, and eventually I realized that, as it turns out, during this time period, 1954-65, right? The French leave in 54, and then the Americans come in 65. During that time period, in North Vietnam, there are still a few countries with diplomatic missions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The Americans get kicked out in 55, so they're not there. So there are no diplomats in North Vietnam reporting on conditions there. But the French are there, the British are there, and the Canadians are there.
Mm.
So what I eventually decided to do was to tap French archives, British archives, Canadian archives, and basically read the records.
The reporting and what
they
were gathering at that time.
Exactly, and what they were basically relating about conditions in Vietnam, about meetings with Vietnamese officials back to their home governments.
And those types of information from those source countries, pretty readily available now. You can go to France, you can go to Ottawa or wherever in Canada they store these.
But again, it's not in one particular place.
Yeah,
so it's a lot of, you ask
puzzles
for several boxes and then you go through them
and
sometimes you get lucky and sometimes you don't. And it's you have to be patient.
Yeah.
It helps to get funded. I mean, thank God I got funded, otherwise this would
This is not the weekend Google research.
No.
This
and
takes
not,
years of painstaking, perseverance and developing leads and following up, going to another site. It's important to, and this is again the role of history. I as a political scientist, we turn to history and we read, what historians can provide us, but we don't always fully appreciate, what it takes to bring something like this together, culling through all this information, and ultimately a story that you're weaving together that's backed by, some real information. Quite fascinating. And I wonder maybe what could you share in terms of reading these different perspectives, what the French, what the British, what the Canadians might be saying about the same thing, what are different, insights or things you could share, different perspectives that they bring to it that informs your story?
It's just looking at the, generally speaking, the British diplomats in North Vietnam were very, very good at reporting information back to, mm-hmm. to London compared to the French. I mean, the Brits would produce every week these very lengthy and detailed reports describing conditions in the north. And then again, those were absolutely invaluable for
and
my purposes.
And these are like cables that they wire back,
and they
were top secret at the time.
Yeah, they have a wireless that they use, and they can relay back to information back to London. And so the Brits, I mean, it was, they would go through all local newspapers, whatever was rendered public in the north, they would go over
summarize it,
send it back to London. Then they would provide, the diplomats on site would provide their own assessments of what's going on. Any meeting they would have with other officials,
what they would basically try to do is
hook up with the Chinese, the Soviets, mm-hmm. to see if those guys had a better sense of what Hanoi was thinking, and relay this back to London.
Mm-hmm.
For the Brits in particular, I guess the records were so good that at one point the Americans started asking the Brits for information about what's going on in the north.
And
that's why I relied less on U.S. documents than I did on French, British, Canadian documents, because as it turns out, the Americans are basically relying on the Brits and the Canadians for information about what's happening in northern Vietnam.
So the French a little more circumscribed, maybe more personal relations rather than writing
every
single thing.
Exactly, and then the Canadians are their records are absolutely fascinating because so you know the British are there because they're technically co-chairmen of the Geneva Conference of 54 that produced the partition of Vietnam.
And
technically it's an open conference, so they're allowed to stay in the north.
Mm.
The French technically signed the Geneva Accords mm-hmm. on Vietnam with the North Vietnamese, mm-hmm. with Ho Chi Minh and all those guys.
And these, of course, just to be clear, they are what helped end the French
The first Indochina
conflict.
War,
yeah.
exactly. So the French are responsible for implementing those agreements, so they get to stay in northern Vietnam.
Mm-hmm.
And the Canadians are there because...
What are they doing there, the Canadians?
So at the conclusion of the war with France, basically, a supervisory commission is set up mm-hmm. to help implement the accords, and the Canadians are on that commission along with the Indians and the Poles.
And so
the Canadians are looking at this from a more detached perspective.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're very close to the Americans. I mean, at the time, Cold War context, they're allies of the United States. But there's a certain level of detachment here that's reflected in the stuff that Canadian diplomats are producing that you don't see in French. And I mean, for the French, for the Brits, this is very important.
Mm-hmm.
For the Canadians, well, we're here to fulfill our role
not
as Canadians,
for them.
They're
baggage.
And
so
you know, one of the great things about doing archival research is that every once in a while you find a real gem, but then you also sometimes come across things that have nothing to do with your research, but which are very interesting.
Yeah.
And the Canadians they're very Canadian in at times because. They're complaining about not being able to watch hockey during playoff season. They're complaining about the quality of the beer. I'm not kidding you. They're complaining about the quality of the beer in Hanoi and how it's not as good as Canadian beer. And then they eventually do something which will serve a big purpose for the French and the Brits. They start a movie night on Tuesdays. They're showing movies at their mission.
Mm-hmm.
And at first the Brits are coming, the French are coming, and then the Russians say they want to come.
But you gotta have alcohol if they're coming.
Well, so then there's a whole dialogue between Ottawa and the Canadian diplomats about whether or not we should invite the Russians.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately the decision is yes, as long as you feed them alcohol so that maybe they start talking to the Brits and the French about what's going on in the minds of North Vietnamese decision makers.
Very strategic, a sort of soft diplomacy there, under the table and on the table.
Wow,
great stories. And again, this is the making of history. It's not, you know, it's not boring stuff. And those who think, oh my gosh, history, no, this is the kind of stuff that you have to understand what goes behind it. And it's a great story. I want to thank you again. And here, Pierre, we'll take a very short break to continue our conversation, but giving our listeners a chance to hear some of the other programming that we do here on ThinkTech. This is Global Connections in the ThinkTech series, and we're talking with Pierre Asselin, a diplomatic historian who's just recently published a book on Hanoi's road to the Vietnam War. We'll be back in just a minute, so stay tuned for more of the story.
Aloha, I'm Nicole Horry for ThinkTech. For nearly half a century, the Hawaii Foreign Trade Zone No. 9 has brought the benefits of the Foreign Trade Zone program to Hawaii businesses and entrepreneurs. DBET, the Department of Business, Economic Development, and Tourism, operates Hawaii's Foreign Trade Zone program to encourage international business and economic development. The Foreign Trade Zone's mission is to increase the amount of international trading activity in Hawaii, thereby providing employment opportunities for the residents of our island state. For more information, see ftz9.org. I'm Nicole Hori. Mahalo.
And welcome. We're back. We're live and we're ThinkTech. This is Global Connections, and we're joined today by Pierre Asselin, who's recently published a pathbreaking book on Hanoi's road to the Vietnam War, the University of California Press. And very exciting, again, just to learn the story that you've been relaying about how you've uncovered this important, and again, what makes it pathbreaking is that clearly you've been able to bring together insights from many key places, particularly the perspective from North Vietnam itself and some of their archives. But equally important, looking at what were others who were there on the ground, the British, the French, the Canadians, and as you know, we can't help but thank the Canadians for their insights because they helped really round up the picture. And you know, even though it may seem funny and tongue-in-cheek, the kind of things you were describing that Canadians were helping to do, bringing together different people there, you know, and the challenges of what that involves, this is great stuff. And I guess I want to further speak to maybe, your one thing is gathering, and you're toiling away, reading and deciphering all this stuff. Of course, another important aspect is talking to people, and here this is something, while it's been some decades away, you still have a large number of people who clearly have their, you know, things they want to share. And so tell us a little bit about what other parts of the story you were able to get by talking to people, Vietnamese themselves, other experts. So
I use interviews very, very little in my work, in part because I don't trust the recollections of participants. Beyond that, the first time I managed to make contact with somebody really, really important was more than 10 years ago, and it was basically the individual who used to be the interpreter for Kissinger's counterpart in the secret talks. Actually, Kissinger came to like this guy so much that Kissinger ultimately made this same Vietnamese guy his interpreter. If you ever see pictures of Lê Duc Tho and Kissinger talking privately, there's always something. A little guy with glasses in the middle.
The one guy,
so I was introduced to that guy, and we really hit it off, basically. But then what happened was that we became friends. And he would share these remarkable stories about what was going on during the talks that wasn't in the transcripts of those talks.
Yeah,
what
yeah.
was going on at the Vietnamese mission in Paris while they weren't meeting with the Americans. And it was so interesting. But I never really used anything he told me simply because I felt like I'd crossed that line. I'd become a friend of his. And sure enough, I mean, every time I would go to Hanoi, I would go to him. He loved reading. And so I would bring him books and he would devour them. And then he would just tell me about, again, the negotiations and all these elements that we never really study as historians because it's minute things, but still, I mean, and the insights I gained from him were really valuable. Because of what happened with them, I decided to kind of stay away from individuals for the purposes of my research and decided to just stick to written documentary evidence. I mean, for better or for worse.
Yeah. No, and I think, and while you may not be citing or quoting him, nevertheless, those stories and that talking and that, you know, those insights you're gaining are helping you to understand
absolutely
opening up, you know, helping you interpret, you know, what this or that may have meant, and so that's vital.
And there was one thing he had told me, I remember, because of course, you know, you always want to get a sense of who these guys are, right? There's very little that's been written about the key decision makers on the North Vietnamese side, and that's one of the reasons why I decided to write the book. But one of the core guys was basically the individual negotiating with Kissinger, and once I asked my friend, the interpreter, I said, you know, by the way, you know, just when you guys weren't negotiating, what would you do? Because you're stuck there, right? I mean, the Americans are bombing your country, and then, you know, you've got relatives fighting, and your wives and kids, and he says, well, you know, one of the things that most of the diplomats were doing was they were taking cooking lessons from the cooks they had. So they learned to cook. and so I thought that was interesting. And then I asked, well, what about Lê Duc Tho? Mm-hmm. You know, the big guy who was there. Essentially Kissinger's counterpart, mm-hmm. and the number two guy in Hanoi. And he said, well, he would spend most of his days in his room reading Marx, reading Lenin, reading Mao, reading Stalin. Mm. And I thought that was so revealing of the mindset of these guys. I always suspected these guys were highly ideological. Mm-hmm. And when he said that, he kind of confirmed it.
Yeah, yeah.
That, I mean, if you've got downtime, right?
I
mean, you could
it,
be watching TV, you could be learning to cook.
Yeah.
Exactly.
All right. That obviously gives him a certain focus, helps to put his mind frame. And I wonder from that if you might talk a little bit about, I mean, here, you've unraveled the story of what leads up in this critical period up, you know, the decade before. And tell us a little bit about the leadership in Vietnam. I don't know if you've got Ho Chi Minh, of course, the sort of the household name we know of, but of course many other players. What was their thinking, and how did that help you explain some of this?
So this is one of the elements that's probably gonna really surprise readers, is that essentially by the time the war against the U.S. begins in 65, Ho Chi Minh and General Giap, who just passed away, they're no longer involved in the policy-making process. Mm-hmm. They've essentially been sidelined. Mm-hmm. They're still used by the guys with power to market the Vietnamese War. Mm-hmm. They become, I mean, Ho Chi Minh becomes Uncle Ho at that point.
Yeah.
But in terms of actual decision-making powers, they have none. Mm-hmm. Ho is essentially the Queen of England mm-hmm. by 65. Yeah.
But before that, he had a prominent role. He was a key leader of bringing the country.
So when they're fighting the French after World War II until 54, mm-hmm. basically, Ho's making the political calls and Giap is winning the military mm-hmm. battles. In 54, the war comes to an end through this negotiated agreement that leads to the partition of Vietnam into North and South. Mm-hmm. A number of communists resent Ho's decision to stop fighting short of reunifying the whole country. Mm-hmm. They're not happy with the decision to end the war basically prematurely.
Yeah.
And sure enough, I mean, Ho thinks that through the agreements, Vietnam could be reunified peacefully within 2 or 3 years, and that never mm-hmm. materializes. Mm-hmm. And the longer Vietnam stays divided, mm-hmm. the more people within the party starts to grumble.
Mm-hmm.
And as it turns out, Ho is very reluctant to consider a military solution because he's afraid of an American intervention in Vietnam. So he's pushing really hard for a diplomatic solution. He's considering the advice provided by the Soviets, the Chinese, who also don't want the Vietnamese to start another war. Mm-hmm. But this doesn't sit well with certain elements within the party. And essentially what happens in late 63, there's a coup in South Vietnam. President Diem is overthrown. Mm-hmm. And essentially within days after that, I claim in the book, there's a coup also in Hanoi.
Mm-hmm.
Where Ho Chi Minh, Giap are basically overthrown in a bloodless, more silent coup.
Mm-hmm.
And these, I call them militants in the book, these militants then take over communist decision making, and within a year or so have essentially set Vietnam on a collision course with the United States.
Yeah. Well, it's an important thing to underscore, you know, how these inner workings, we often have a misperception that there was a leader and everyone was clearly behind it. There's a lot of internal dynamics and power broker things. We're going to continue the story in just a moment after a short break. I'm Carlos Juarez. We're in Global Connections, part of the ThinkTech series, and joined today by Pierre Asselin, a great story about some of the early periods leading up to the Vietnam War. We'll be back in just a minute, so please stay tuned for more of the story.
Aloha, I'm Jay Fidel, founder of ThinkTech Hawaii. We are a digital media nonprofit that covers things that matter to tech, energy, diversification, globalism, and progress for our state, the state of Hawaii. We broadcast on community television and on Oceanic Cable Channel 16. We also stream our shows and interviews live on the internet as both radio and video, and of course, we post them here on YouTube. We collaborate with the Hawaii Venture Capital Association to present monthly luncheon programs on subjects of interest to the business community. And we write for the Honolulu Star Advertiser. ThinkTech works hard to raise public awareness in Hawaii. Check out our website, thinktechhawaii.com, and come to our YouTube channel, ThinkTech Hawaii. We hope you support our mission and that you like our work. I'm Jay Fidel. Mahalo.
And welcome back. We're live, and we're ThinkTech, and this is the Global Connection Show. Your host, Carlos Juarez, joined today by Pierre Asselin. And we've been having a great story, talking about a new book he's just published by the University of California Press, Hanoi's Road to the Vietnam War, 1954 to 1965. And we were just getting a little bit of insights into, you know, the people, the players in basically Vietnam. And in this period, we often have this perception that, you know, Ho Chi Minh was the, you know, Uncle Ho calling the shots. But clearly, as you've uncovered and described in here, we've suddenly got a changing dynamics, new players. So tell us a little bit about who suddenly is calling the shots.
So the guy who calls the shots in Hanoi by 65 is actually a guy from the south, who makes his way back to Hanoi and basically slowly but gradually works to isolate Ho Chi Minh, whom he considers basically too moderate. Mm-hmm. The guy in question is named Le Duan, L-E-D-U-A-M. And it's interesting because most Americans have no idea who he is. I've never heard of him. And the ironic thing is that he's basically the architect of the whole war against the United States. The Tet Offensive, the turning point of the war, which following Zapp's passing, many people said, oh, this was Zapp's big... Zapp had nothing to do with that. This was the same guy, Le Duan, that this was his idea. And basically, we need to think of him as a Mao or a Stalin. He's an individual who basically takes over party decision making in 63 and doesn't give up that power until he dies in 1986. Mm-hmm. The guy's in power for 23 years. So he never liked Ho Chi Minh. I mean, he respected the guy because he was essentially the embodiment of the Vietnamese revolution and the whole communist effort. But in terms of authority and power, it's primarily in the hands of this one individual. His closest assistant is Le Duc Tho, the guy who eventually is sent to negotiate secretly with Kissinger in Paris. And so in this sense, I think it's perfectly fair to compare Kissinger-Nixon to Le Duc Tho and Le Duan.
No.
Kissinger had played a very prominent role in U.S. foreign policy making, and as did Le Duc Tho. Ultimately, Nixon was calling the shots. In Hanoi, Le Duan was calling the shots. These four guys have so much in common. And it's one of the reasons why Kissinger respected Tho so much, and Tho respected Kissinger a lot. I mean, they were committed to certain principles, and that commitment is one of the reasons why it took so long to end the Vietnam War. These are not guys who were easily willing to compromise on what they thought was important.
No, it's fascinating. And I mean, the way you describe them as having so much in common, it's just fascinating. You can see the story of leaders. And, you know, too often when we look at something like the Vietnam War, I mean, there are many factors, many explanations, the Cold War, all these sort of macro institutional, systemic. In so many conflicts, you have to look at the individuals and the choices that these leaders have made, the way in which they exercise power and control. And, you know, what could you say, I guess, about the style of his leadership? Because after all, Vietnam, you know, does come out of the Cold War context. It is a communist party. I mean, it has, you know, the impact of either, you know, China or the Russians. I mean, what lessons do they draw from, you know, either those players, or, you know, did they have their own form of power and
Absolutely.
Decision?
So, you know, we often make a big deal of the Soviets and the Chinese in this whole equation, right?
Holding all the strings.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And we've for long suggested that the Chinese and the Soviets were basically telling the Vietnamese what to do. I talk about that in the book. It's actually the opposite. It's the Vietnamese who are manipulating the Soviets and the Chinese. I found this great quote. At one point, the Russians are completely exasperated. The Soviet ambassador in Hanoi is totally exasperated. He goes to the French, general delegate, and the French general delegate thinks that the Soviet ambassador has been drinking. But he just shows up at the mission, the Soviet ambassador starts talking about the Vietnamese, and he asks the French guy, so what do you guys think about those North Vietnamese? And the French guy says, well, blah, 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 blah. And the Soviet ambassador says, you know what, I gotta tell you this, just between the two of us. they're not brotherly at all. They never listen to the advice we give them, and they're too independently minded. And of course, the first thing the French delegate does, he reports everything back to Paris. And it was such a telling moment. The Sino-Soviet dispute is going on at this time,
and
the Vietnamese are fully aware of it. And they're full advantage.
Yeah, exactly. Playing one off the other.
Because the whole world is watching what's happening in Vietnam, right? Mm-hmm. So if the Soviets don't help, the Chinese will accuse the Soviets of not being the true leaders of the communist camp, which in a way the Chinese were doing. Mm-hmm. If the Chinese don't do anything, then the Soviets will accuse them of being basically big barkers but little doers. Yeah. And what do the Vietnamese do? Did they go to the Soviets? You guys should help us here, because if you don't, we'll have to turn to the Chinese. And they tell the Chinese the same thing at the same time. So it's fascinating the extent to which this small actor was able to basically control events during a crucial period in Vietnam's history.
You look today, it's such a fascinating, you fast forward 40 plus years from this period, 50 years, and Vietnam today, here's a country that is now suddenly reopened and engaged and connected to the world. You know, even here in Hawaii, we're sending groups of high school students that are going there and learning firsthand. And you had an opportunity a couple years ago to take a group of our own students from the Hawaii Pacific University. This is not the Hawaii, the Vietnam of the grandparents and of this period. Just thinking of the country itself, it was able to kind of either reaffirm its identity or its own ability to control its destiny, and today is very much an independent nation.
But the thing is this, everything changes in Vietnam in 1986 when Lay Duan dies.
At that point,
the Vietnam undergoes a process of what they call Doi Moi, or renovation. Mm. They start opening up.
Yeah.
Soviet Union collapses. Now they really have to open up. They start reaching out to the Americans. They start developing better ties with the Chinese. And slowly but gradually, Vietnam integrates the world, becomes of the world for the first time. Yeah. But again, I think the critical element in all of this is the death of this individual in 1986.
And
it's not coincidence that things begin to change in the late 1980s.
Yeah, and this is a time as well. I mean, you look at China under Deng Xiaoping, mid-80s, suddenly transformation, opening to the world. I know that with Vietnam it took some time, but over time, even those who saw the painful history that it was for the U.S., our withdrawal and the war that didn't quite end as neatly as we were used to, very difficult from our side to re-engage and to somehow legitimize the country.
But that's an important element we need to understand. It's the same thing for the Vietnamese, if not worse. The government celebrates their victory over the Americans. The people don't. If you talk to the average Vietnamese about the war, it's even the guys on the winning side, it's nothing but painful memories. There's no question that the United States and its people suffered a great deal before the war. The people in Vietnam, including those on the winning side, suffered. It's stunning the extent to which these people suffered. And so there's as far as they're concerned, there's nothing to celebrate about this war. And if anything, they blame that individual, Lay Duan, for forcing them to fight for as long as they did. To the same extent that we like to have these debates in this country about whether or not Nixon could have ended the war in 68 or 69, the Vietnamese are having the same debates about whether or not Lay Duan could have ended the war earlier.
Yeah.
And there's a sense that war lasted way too long. Mm-hmm. Not because of the Americans, but because of our own leaders.
Yeah. Oh, this is such an important understanding of this critical period in our history. And I think, I just want to commend you for what you've done in this book, bringing pieces of the puzzle, digging out archives in Vietnam as a Canadian, going to London, going to France and Paris, the archives, you have found all of this that helps you really structure an interpretation. And again, it's history that's being redefined. And maybe as a parting note, and we'll finish our show on this, why is it important for history to be continually revisited? And somebody's been many books written about the Vietnam War, but you've come along now and given sort of a new a new focus. I mean, give us some concluding thoughts on why it's important for us to kind of keep history I don't know if alive, but at least, you know, continually look for answers. Well,
first, to clarify, now I have dual citizenship. I'm also American now. So it's and so, yeah. So, no, I think this stuff is important because, I mean, history, my students often think that it's static and it's always changing. Mm-hmm. There's myriad different ways of interpreting the past. The Vietnam War is a fascinating subject of study. And as long as new evidence is forthcoming, mm-hmm. there'll be new ways of interpreting that war, of looking back upon that war. Yeah. And to me, that's what makes history so engaging, yeah. is that it's so alive, it's constantly changing. Yeah. It can constantly be reinvented, retold, mm-hmm. in ways that perhaps we never heard before. Yeah.
No, this has been a great opportunity to really learn. I want to, you know, I'm sorry we have to come to an end. I know we'll have perhaps opportunities to continue this conversation, but we are out of time. We're going to have to wrap it up at this point. I'm Carlos Juarez. We've been in this Global Connection show talking with Pierre Asselin, a diplomatic historian here at Hawaii Pacific University, and unraveling just a great story in his newest book, Hanoi's Road to the Vietnam War, 1954 to 1965. I want to thank all of you for joining us here, and especially thank many who made this show possible. Ian Montana, who's our communications director, Chrissy Goffigan, and to Jay Fidel, who helps us bring all of this together. And of course, I want to thank you, our listeners, for joining us and for listening. ThinkTech will be back next week with a continued show here. This part of the series, Global Connections, helps to bring people with important things to share. And we're just delighted, Pierre, that you've been able to tell us more about this story. If you'd like to get our daily emails and media, social media advisories, make sure to click the link at thinktechhawaii.com. If you'd like to be a guest, a sponsor, or a ThinkTech underwriter, contact Jay at thinktechhawaii.com. I want to thank you so much, and remember that we broadcast live on the internet, and we come to you here from the exciting core of downtown Honolulu at Pioneer Plaza. I'm going to leave with that, and of course, see you next week on our next show, Global Connections. Aloha.